It's a real doozy blues to sing. Just don't hang up, moving on to a better spot. I can't hear you, can't get through. Why you gonna be mine or not? I never slumber, I got your number, baby. You are the one for me. I can't be quiet, this rings a riot, cause it seems on the harmony. Yeah, I'll do without your ring, ding-a-ling, and it's a real doozy blues to sing. Yeah. Real doozy blues to sing, a real doozy blues to sing, real doozy blues, real doozy blues, real doozy blues. A two
Yay! Whoa. Welcome, my guest, Deborah Pearl.
Gosh, who's that?
You have a lot of different things to you, girly.
I guess so. Hello, hi, Cathy. Hello, people out there, friends and strangers. Old and new.
Friends and strangers, and new friends and new strangers.
Strangers, absolutely.
Deborah Pearl. So, hi.
Hi.
So glad to have you on.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much.
You're one of my more unusual guests because of your reach into different careers.
Yeah, kind of. I mean, it's a strange thing because I link them somehow in my, you know, in my head, because of I think like every person is a melody. And so when I started writing, I would hear the what people said, and I would take it down like dictation, and the characters would have a rhythm and a melody. So it kind of linked together for me that
that's cool.
You know, that it's all communication. So the music is nonverbal, and the verbal stuff just puts it into another location in our receivers.
That's really cool. That's a definite point of an artist point of view, for sure. That's your point of view.
Yeah. I'm flattered by the term, but yes, I guess.
Well, to me it is, because it's like, I mean, you know, we've all talked to lots of people, but every now and then you talk to like some artist who's, for instance, I have a friend, when you talk to her, She does this. She'll, you're talking to her, and when she goes to answer you, she'll do this.
Oh.
You know, and I got it. I got that she's looking at her universe, you know. And
it's like her antenna is going to get the transmission.
Yeah, and as a matter of fact, you know, like I always think that guitar players go to guitar land, you know. I mean, they could be talking to you, and if they have the guitar in their hand and they're playing a little, like they're whatever, they're in guitar land. They may be talking to you, but they are in guitar land, you know.
Yeah. No, it's funny because Michael sometimes play on a table.
Yeah. You
know, and his fingers are going, and you know, you just something expressing something through himself that way. So it's a really interesting topic for lyricists in particular, because I kind of got into lyric writing, and you know, the notion of trying to take a melody and somehow find the words that belong to it.
Yeah.
You know, through your own personal filter of how it makes you feel and what it makes you feel, you know, which I did with the Benny Carter stuff.
Yeah. I can't remember if we've talked about this before. I'm sure we have, because you told me about it, you know, when we hooked up again after all that time. Yeah. So why Benny Carter?
I had the great good fortune to know and love Benny. He and his wife Hilma were like surrogate parents to me. I was so blessed. I had met Hilma many years ago at the Barnard Club of Los Angeles, because I went to Barnard in New York, and she's also a graduate, you know, obviously many, many years my senior, but we became really great close friends. And I would, you know, I just would go over to their house, and they lived on Skyline Drive, and I would just sit with them. And it was just a sense of peace that would come over me, that, you know, being in his presence, and he was so humble. And I was working with Lou Forestieri, which I've been working with Lou over the years, for many years. And so we'd go over, we wrote a song, and I brought it to Benny and played it for him. And I did my one woman show, Chick Singers, and they came twice to see it.
Huh.
And he said to me, you know, I play one of the characters as a jazz singer. And he said to me, you could be a jazz singer if you wanted. And, you know, at the time, I'm like a writer and I'm doing other things, and I'm thinking, you know, you idiot, this man told you you could be a jazz singer. And I'm like, oh, no, I don't want to do that, you know. So I was like, you know, so silly. But anyway, I, you know, eventually, posthumously, got to write lyrics to 13 of his melodies and make this, create this album, Listen to Us Date Ourselves.
I still call it albums.
Which is, they're extinct now, so.
Yeah.
But anyway, this body of work that, you know, was another really amazing connection to him, because I had his titles, so I knew kind of what he meant, and then just had to like ingest the music to see what came out, you know, what I heard. It was a really amazing and fortunate process. I'm very, very grateful to Hilma.
Yeah. You know,
it actually began because she someone had sent her an unsolicited lyric to one of Kenny's tunes. And she said, "You're a writer, what do you think?" And I read it and I was like, oh. You know? And I said, you know, gosh, if you're looking, would you mind if I took a shot at it? She goes, no, that's a great idea. Go ahead and do it. So I did, and that was People Time, which has actually been recorded a couple times. And that's a, you know, it's a really lovely melody and lyric of Benny. So anyway, and then that began the process.
Yeah. For some reason, I couldn't find People Time in that list. I wonder if I can just
it's on Amazon, or it's on, I think it should be somewhere, but
People Time, Deborah Pearl, or
yeah
let's see if it comes up and I can play it. Oh, it does come up on YouTube, it just didn't come up. It would be nice to hear it. Do you
if
mind?
If you'd like to stay strong and independent as
you. Ad.
Yeah, I'd like to stay strong and independent.
Me too, man.
These people, man.
So this is People Time.
Lonely nights, my mind spins toward the dawn. Time has stopped because, love, you are gone. Lovers rendezvousing out of time. Out of place, yet never once out of mind. You're my ray of sunshine through the rain. You're the laughter underneath my pain. I reach for your memory and dream you back to me. Magically, you're always mine in People Time. Like the scent of spring, you linger on. Angels have no wings without your song. Can't tell dreams from what is really mine. Don't care, love is real in People Time. One day when this one-way trip is through, I'll reminisce in heaven with you. And I'll bless each night sublime, you're forever mine. If it's only in my mind, in People Time. Thank you. is really mine. I don't care. Love is real in people time. One day when this one-way trip is through, I'll reminisce in heaven with you. And I'll bless each night sublime, you're forever mine. If it's only in my mind, in people time, in people time, you're never out of mind in people time.
Really nice song. Awesome. Beautiful. Nice lyrics.
I want to thank Hilma again for giving me that opportunity. And I love her. I sent her she's 99.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And so I don't know. I sent her the links and stuff. So I don't know if she's watching, but Hilma, I love you. And I miss you. She's amazing. She's, you know, a remarkable, remarkable person. And I love her dearly.
Wow. Well, that people time. So I'm just curious, how did you come up with that people time? Because it sounds like what you described, going over and hanging out with them.
Well, no, interesting. Yeah, no, I hadn't thought about that. But I think that was his title. I used his titles whenever I could.
Yes.
Maybe making a slight adjustment, like Souvenir, it's called Souvenir. I'll talk about that before I sing it, but that there's a story to that. But you know, they're almost all "Sail Away" was "Sail Away with Me" to "Sail Away." I mean, it just I took what he said, and you know his like "Happy Feet" is a title that was his title, and "Wonderland."
Well, let me ask you this: what exactly does "People Time" mean?
People time is, you know, the totality of where we live, like consciousness, you know, because love exists after people are gone. Love transcends time. So people time is the time in which we have consciousness of one another, which doesn't have to do with our lifespan or, you know what I mean? Or
yeah, sure.
So it's funny because I'm realizing that thematically, I talk about that a lot. In lyrics, in love lyrics, about people, you know, that you love in your mind. But for many years, you know, I was, you know, I've had relationships here and there, but it's been a long time for me since my last one, and I've never married and stuff like that. So I think I spent a lot of years in my fantasy, in my mind, where a lot of this stuff that I express kind of must have been impacted by. I used to say I could have a whole relationship with someone with having met them once. I could go through the whole thing and the upset and the rejection and all that. I was a writer because that was I amused myself while I was alone.
That's interesting.
I was never at a loss for like things to do or think about.
That's funny. So since you've been in a relationship now, has that part changed?
Well, I think
in the writing, the expressing of it.
Well, no, that part hasn't been impacted so much as the fact that I've developed myself as a person enough to be able to be in a relationship, because that had to do with my growth, and I spent many, 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 many years in therapy with one wonderful man who's sadly no longer with us, Richard Carr, with him. But anyway, a number of music people, you know, knew him. And but in my work with him over 30 plus years, I was able to, and I like to put it this way, become who I was supposed to be, but didn't know it, you know? So it's about becoming. I don't, you never stop becoming, but you know, you get a hold of enough of yourself. And it's funny because I'm writing a book about it, about creativity and personal growth.
Oh.
And it's a lot of what I learned from Dick and Richard. And it really has to do with, like, you grow up and you have a template in your family dynamic, and then you hold it up to other people and they become part of your template, you know. You're not really doing anything but replaying the old from your past. And until you can kind of put that aside and refocus your lens and see the same thing differently, you know, you're kind of stuck. And so that kind of ultimately brought me to a place now where I can, you know, love someone and love the totality of who they are. And when they do things that are not comfortable for me, I can see that it's about them and not me, instead of making it about me and then going out with swords to try to, you know, outdo the other one. And
yeah.
And you know, it's like not, I remember saying to my mother once that my parents were married for 70 years when my father died on there. I think he died like the day before their 70th anniversary. And I remember, I think probably about year 50, I said, why are you complaining? Because they used to argue a lot. And I used to say, Mom, and my mother's alive. She's 99.
Oh.
Also another amazing.
Oh.
But she needs care. And, you know, she's not all there all the time. Yeah. Anyway, but just, so at the time, this was like on their, they were married 50 years. And so she's like complaining to me about something my father did. And I went, Mom, it's been 50 years he's been doing that. Do you really think he's going to change? You know, it's like, what is that about? It's like a dance. It's like a routine. They do that samba with each other, you know. But find a more pleasant way to dance, you know. It's like, it's, ugh. Anyway. Life is a...
Yeah, that's pretty funny. Well, the record is really beautiful. And, you know, who doesn't love and admire Benny Carter's music, you know?
What a genius he was.
Yeah. Neil Rosengarten, history repeats itself. Repeats, yes. And Cecily Gardner said...
Neil, I say hi. Hi, Neil.
And Cecily Gardner's here too, and she said, really beautiful.
Thank you.
Actually, she said, really gorgeous. Sorry, Steph. Oh, okay. Sorry, Cecily.
Well, I'll take gorgeous.
So I saw an adorable picture on your website of you and your sister.
Oh yeah.
That looked just
the Pearl album. Great.
Yeah.
Oh
so,
yeah.
So where did you grow? I mean, you know, I like to try and, you know, don't have people like, oh, I grew up and blah, blah, blah. But it's interesting to know, where did you grow up, and did you grow up in a creative family? And
I grew up in Bucks County, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
Born in Trenton, New Jersey.
Sorry.
My dad's business was in Trenton. Mm-hmm. And right on the Delaware Canal. Really a great place to grow up. My sister Leslie was a musical prodigy.
And
she was a prodigy on piano and became like the first harpsichord major at BU and went on to write wonderful songs. And, you know, this was, you know, her album. She produced it and wrote all the songs and stuff. And then went on to the second album, and she's had songs placed and stuff. Anyway, she went on to have a jingle company in New York for many years and wrote the Folgers jingle. And the best part of waking up is Folgers in your cup.
Wow.
Yeah, so she did that.
Yeah.
And anyway, so that was her. My father, in midlife, took a painting and was a really lovely painter. And he would go to the JCC with all the ladies, like him and all the women. And it was hilarious. And he got very friendly with Gregorio Prestipino, who was an artist from like the Riverside, New Jersey School of Artists. He was a known artist. Prestipino. In fact, Greg Prestipino, I don't know if you know, do you know Greg Prestipino?
I do not.
He's a songwriter, and I guess I contacted him when I first got out here because of my dad's relationship with his dad. He was very friendly with Andrew Gold, who was a very close friend of mine. You know, you did you know Andrew or
no? Yeah, a lot of these names I'm not going to know. I bet.
Oh, okay. But you know who Andrew Gold was? Do you know?
No.
Oh, singer songwriter, lonely boy. Oh, 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 what a lonely boy. And thank you for being a friend. That was a
that I remember. I mean, that's
girl. That was Andrew's song.
Friend. Oh, okay.
And his dad was Ernest Gold, who wrote the theme to Exodus. Big, like,
oh.
And his mom, we'll talk about an artistic family. His mother was Marnie Nixon.
Oh, wow.
Who sang all the, yeah, so wonderful.
Wow.
Artistic lineage. Mine was the JCC lineage. JCC painter. No, my father was very creative. He's a brilliant man, actually, and very, very creative person. And my brother, who went into business ultimately with my dad, he's now writing books. So in fact, I just helped him with it, do an edit for his second novel. So yes, I would say our family is creative.
And you started in your creativity. Did you start singing, writing? What did you start?
I originally wanted to be a performer. I went to Barnard and I couldn't wait to get out. I actually graduated in 3 years because I just wanted to, you know, get out and do life. And I ended up actually going to Nepal for a year.
Wow.
Because, yeah. After I graduated, my then boyfriend, who was the librarian at Barnard College, got a Fulbright. So I became Mamsab for a year. And I'll never forget the phone call telling my parents, because I had gone to England for the summer to work in a theater that the professor at Barnard then had a summer theater in the West Country. And I'll never forget this. I said, I'm going to go to you know, India and live in Nepal for a year. And I remember my mother going, Irving, tell her no. That's like my shining
memory. Now why wouldn't, I'm trying to imagine. I guess my mother wouldn't want me just traveling, you know, to some other country. Is that basically it?
Yeah, well, you know, then I just said, well, thank you for sharing. I'll see you when I get back, you know. So I went from England and met Bob. And Bob Palmer is still a very good friend of mine, and he's in New York. And but anyway, I had an amazing, fascinating year there, and then came back. And it was really funny when you're in another culture and, you know, even a bathroom. You know, we have bathrooms with the sinks and the bidets and the showers and the tubs and the thing and all this, you know. And like there, it's like a hole with 2 feet, you know. I mean, it's just a different experience. Or it's like the end of the village. It's, you know, it's behind the tree.
Yeah.
So, and I remember even like they would wrap, you know, saris. People would have just a simple way of clothing themselves, and then you realize we have billions of dollars of industry about like the adornments that we put on ourselves. It's just interesting, you know. I was impacted by that when I first came back, thinking, wow, how different is Western culture?
Yeah. What did you do in India?
Well, a couple of things. I directed a play at an American school. I wrote I wrote them in college, but I wrote like my first sort of major work that I actually returned to 18 years later. And it became a play that I developed, and I wrote. I mean, I guess that was where I was already by that time well schooled of living in my head and my fantasy and stuff. I remember actually as a kid in my bedroom doing my homework, I would use voices. I would read the stuff in like accents and things, you know. But the news of the triangle is on the right side of the, you know, because I don't know, I guess I wasn't bored. I just wanted to do more than shove it in.
You were intrigued by it. You were curious. And curiosity is creativity, right?
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Totally. everybody's creative. They just don't identify it.
Exactly. So, okay. So India, and it impacted you, I can imagine. And plus you were young college age too. So
yeah, no, I was,
of course.
Yeah,
so of course you're going to get impacted, you know. And so you came back, and what did you do when you came back?
Oh, gosh, when I came back, I started singing with my sister.
Yeah.
We started doing stuff, and I was auditioning for shows. I can't remember the total chronology of this because I was in a couple of musicals.
This was New York, right?
I was in New York, and I was in the sequel to Hair, Rainbow. And I was, you know, I did theater a little bit, but you know, my problem with being a performer, though I loved it and I still love it, which is what the return to was, my Chick Singer show, which, you know, was fun, was that I couldn't go to those auditions and have, there were 12 girls there and me, I thought, well, they have to want somebody else. Oh, look at her. She said that, you know, and I just would kill myself. I would be so beaten up by the time I got, they called my name.
God.
Oh, thank you. You know, there's that story, the, what's it called? The, oh, there's a name for it about the tire when the person comes to the door and they convince themselves that they, you know, oh, keep your freaking phone. I don't want it. You know, it's like they do the same thing. But anyway, so I wasn't emotionally, again, I wasn't emotionally up to the task.
Yeah.
So I was sort of more comfortable creating in my space.
And
ultimately, but my sister and I, you know, did our album together. I moved out here. This was a big deal coming from New York to Los Angeles.
Yeah.
So I wanted to write for television. That was my aim. And, you know, I actually had been writing my first spec in New York. I was working for an agent, and I remember I broke my ankle, what I would say, skiing down Broadway. I was wearing, remember those platform shoes from the late 70s, I guess.
Yes.
And I twisted my ankle and cracked it right on Broadway, and it was so and the best part of that story was when I got to the hospital, some stranger called 911. They took me to the hospital, and I'm laying there next to another woman, and I'm so embarrassed. I'm hoping she doesn't ask me how I did it, because I was walking down Broadway. So she ends up telling me that she broke her leg putting her pants on. You know how you hop, 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 and then she broke her leg. And I thought, oh, there is a God, you know. someone broke their in a more embarrassing way than I did.
Oh God.
Anyway, but then I moved out here and with my pilot and stayed in an aunt's. I had a relative out here.
Yeah.
And I loved it. I came to Los Angeles, and for some reason I just, and it's so funny, when I drove out here and you come in on the 10, and you know, you have an image of California and this, and you're on the 10 and you're seeing like McDonald's and nothing, like the shopping centers. I'm going, this is what I moved to? You know? I was like, wow, you know. And then there were heavy people. You know, I thought everybody out here was beautiful, you know.
Right, right.
God, there's old people and heavy people. It was like, and of course, I ended up just, you know, there's just something again about the West, the frontier of it. I don't know.
Yeah.
I can't really tell you why, but I mean, aside from the fact that I still love the mountains, I still, the topography here, the ocean, the mountains, it's still breathtaking. I ended up getting a house from I ended up doing 10 years writing sitcoms.
Oh.
I partnered with someone that I wrote a sitcom in New York with a neighbor of mine who had come out here before me, and he had gone on, Michael Baser, to become an executive producer. So he hooked me up with his then girlfriend. and so she and I, he gave us our first job. So we got to write a half hour. And we went on and had 10 years. The last two, I was alone. She had decided to go back to Texas. And
so, what kind of shows were you writing?
Well, the very best show was Designing Women. Hands
you down. Wrote for Designing Women. I loved that show.
Yeah, it was a wonderful show. And I loved Harry. I mean, Harry Thomason. And I still love Harry. And Linda is brilliant. She's just a genius writer. And they were great. And it was a really great. And Pam Norris also was an exec. She's sort of handling it more hands-on at one point when we were there. So it was amazing. I mean, I remember when we were in a trailer and Linda comes in and says, oh, you know, our friends, Bill and Hillary, are thinking of running for president, and we're going to go and meet with them tonight. We're going to decide whether or not, you know, because he, you know, he's evidently, you know, has gotten around, and so we want to make sure, you know, so it's always like, so anyway. That was an amazing. I mean, we had great fun. We had an amazing run, and I really loved it. One of the first jobs we had gotten was on a variety show with Sammy Davis Jr.
Oh boy,
as the guest, which was like, oh my god. Yeah. I mean, it's funny. I have this wonderful picture of the three of us, of my partner and I, with our arms around Sammy, and it got stuck to like the. You know how they get moisture and they get stuck to the glass? So I can't ever touch that thing. It's like a fossil now. You know? But we used to get invited to Sammy's. He used to have movie nights at his house.
Oh.
And in Bel Air, you know, Beverly Hills-ish, wherever. And I'll never forget, you walk in and in the foyer, there's like a display unit, and he had a pair of the ruby slippers. From the Wizard of Oz, I was like, what? You know, unbelievable. And then, you know, everybody sat on his Gucci couch. And this was long before the big screen TVs, you know, but he had like a big screen TV of some sort or a movie thing. And it was very exciting. It was fun. We had a great run. We did some fun shows, and Irma Kalish was sort of our mentor, and I'll never forget her. She was in her 60s. We did our first big show. We had written one episode, I think, of the head of the class.
Uh-huh.
And actually, Dan Frischman, who played Arvid, has become a dear friend of mine over the years. And you know, she was, we did What's Happening Now, which was the reboot of What's Happening. And I'll never forget, she was in her 60s, and how hard it was to be a woman of age back then, in particular, too. I mean, that has not changed. But how, you know, the studio wouldn't return calls, and you know, it was just, and she'd have to dye her hair. I mean, you know, there were all kinds of things that I saw coming in as a young woman. And then, of course, lived to experience that myself, you know. But it's an interesting business, you know. It's a business. It's a business of show, and so, you know, it's a wonderful thing when things are wonderful. It can be very awkward when you have it's like the fish stinks from the head, like we're all experiencing now politically.
Yeah.
You know, if you're on a show and the person that's running it is problematic, then it's problematic. If they're wonderful people, which most of them were, you just pinch yourself. You know, I get to do this, and we make each other laugh all day, and then it's crazy. It's just so much fun. And but it wasn't for me. Interestingly, I did it backwards because uh-huh. I wasn't a playwright first. Kind of, I was really wanted TV, and then while I was working in television, I would work at night on my plays. Because in television, it's a group, you know, you're all contributing, and it's, if you want your own voice or to find your own voice, you need to, unless it's your show and you're the showrunner, it's not as pure an expression of one's particular voice.
Yeah.
And great talent to being able to get into the voice of what is the show's intention is and making that work, you know. that's a brilliant talent, and I know wonderful, brilliant people who do that. Mm-hmm. Me, it ultimately did not satisfy when all was said and done. It just, you know, I was not not feeling like, I mean, I look back and I go, God, I probably should have tried to stay a few more years. but hindsight.
So do, in that industry, do people actually start with plays first, generally speaking, and then they go into TV?
Well, I mean, a lot of people do. That's how a lot of people come up that way. Uh-huh. And I mean, today all bets are off because so much has changed. The technology has changed that, you know, young people can do their own YouTube shows and they can, you know, you can shoot your own shows. I had longed to direct for many years, and it was a few years ago. I don't know if you know Vicki Abelson. Do you know Women Who Write?
Yeah,
called Women Who Write, and on Tuesdays, and she has people come in, and a lot of musicians, and they perform and sell CDs and stuff. It's wonderful. And she's terrific. And a dear friend of hers is a dear friend of mine, Cindy Beagle, who had asked, because I've been friends with Ed Asner since working on a show of his many years ago, something called Thunder Alley with Robin Riker. And Haley Joel Osment, who was 5 years old, and he was the co-star, and he and Ed would have scenes together, and you wouldn't believe. I wouldn't believe it. I mean, it's unbelievable how amazing the kids' timing was, you know. Anyway, so they had asked me to ask Ed to be on the show, to come to her thing, perform, and would I write something for him if he didn't have something? And I had asked him, I said, well, would you, you know, do you have something? You want to do some of your one-man show? Because he has, you know, a one-man show, and he has another show that some friends of mine wrote that he's doing called God Help Us. And it's Phil Proctor and Sam Joseph. Anyway, so he said, nah, I don't want to do that, you know. And he looks at me and goes, write me a fucking scene. So I said, I'll write you a fucking scene. And I walked away and I thought, a fucking scene? I'll put him with Hooker. So I wrote this scene of this older gentleman with a hooker. And it was very funny and everybody really enjoyed it. And I played the hooker. And then I asked him, just, you know, off the cuff, I said, Ed, would you be willing, if I made a movie of this, would you do it? And he said, oh, sure, I'll do it. And so I thought to myself, oh my goodness, I've been wanting to do this for so long, and there's always some reason I'm too scared to get past, you know? So he said yes, and I a musical of mine that I wrote with David Cole called The Bistro Garden was being done in outside of Detroit. So I went there to work on it for like 6 weeks, and I lived with the producer, Barbie Weiserman, and her husband, Jeff. So I told her about this thing, and she said, oh my God, let's do it. I'll help you raise the money. And I was like in a panic, you know, my heart started to pound. Oh my God. So I called my friend Cynthia Stefanoni, who I've known forever, who's this wonderful first AD, and she had first AD'd the first thing that I had written. One of my one acts, two of my one acts were made into short films. So Waiting for a Vet was the first one. So I called her up and said, Cynthia, what do you think I should do? You know, and she said, come on board, let's do it. You know, so I hung up the phone and I went, I have to do it. I have to do it. So I kind of, and it's so funny because I write about this in my book, about the thought of the challenge in life, that you're looking up at a mountain and you think, oh my God, can I do this? When in essence, what it ends up being is reaching your hand out to a person that you know and love, and getting help, or someone you don't know, but it's getting assistance and getting more assistance and getting more assistance. So it ends up being a series of you know, you don't do anything alone in this life, you know. So it's just a matter of engaging.
Yeah,
we did a Kickstarter thing. I had to gauge a lot of people for that. We raised about $40,000, so it was you know. And my dear friend, I don't know if you know Kevin and Victoria, well, Kevin Hayes and his wife.
Yeah, yeah, Victoria. Kevin Hayes.
Yeah, you know Kevin Hayes. Well, anyway, dear, dear friend, he and Victoria. I miss them, they're in New York now. So anyway, he had done music. He did film music for me on the first one. It's just killer. You know, the importance of music in a comedy is just so important. And he just knew just what to do. And so he came in for this thing and actually killed it. He has a thing, now it's like silence that speak. He wrote rock musicals to silent films, which were amazing. Huh. And doing all sorts of stuff. I mean, I really feel so blessed. I know so many like wonderful, wonderful friends that, you know, every time I've done something. And, you know, Neil's cousin, John Charles, I want to shout out. I've known Neil for, you know, 40 years. I used to have Thanksgiving with the Charleses every year. And I miss John so much. You know, he was so helpful with the record. I mean, I just, you know, when you have friends that like, it's moving, and I'm just deeply grateful.
Yeah.
Ray was, you know, Ray and Bernice were, I was just privileged to know these people because.
Yeah. Well, I saw that movie that you're speaking of with Ed Asner. I loved it.
Oh, it's Getting It Late.
Yeah, I loved it. Oh, that was really cool.
I called Jean. I worked with her on Designing Women, and she had some thoughts for the script. I said, well, let me, can I do a rewrite? She was doing Fargo at the time. And, you know, when she was flying up to Vancouver, I guess, where they shot it. And she says to me, you know, I my hair is short, and I, you know, they have me not looking so good. I said, oh, don't worry, we'll wig you, you know, this is not a problem. And we got a big wig for that. But at any rate, so I had, after we'd done the shoot and everything, I thought, God, you know, I never saw Fargo. I really have to see Jean's work on Fargo. So I turn and I start watching it, and I'm like going, you know, it's like about like 30 seconds go by, and I all of a sudden I go, oh my God, that's Jean. You know, she had so transformed herself. I mean, talk about great actors, you know. She had so, her center of gravity had shifted. I mean, the whole, her way she carried herself, her shoulders were, I'm so in awe of actors. I mean, Ed the same way. I mean, Ed, there's not a funny moment that Ed will miss in a sandbox, you know. He'll pick out a grain of sand for the funny, you know. It's just, there are people who know this, and it's really humbling, you know.
Yeah. Who was she in Fargo? The movie, right?
No, this was the television show. It was one of the,
oh,
she was nominated, okay, for an Emmy for this role. She played like the head of this, you know, awful murderous family.
Okay.
And I mean, to go from like, you know, who she was, I had asked her to do the Southern accent to recall the Charlene character from.
Yeah, yes.
And interesting, she was the only one that wasn't Southern in that cast. And she was so Southern, you know, it was like amazing. She's a lovely person. I mean, really, and Ed is, I just love that man. He's been there. He's done lots of play readings for me over the years. He's always been there.
I recommend that little movie. That was really.
Oh, getting, yeah, I really watch it. Watch it. Everybody watch it on Amazon. You get a giggle, hopefully.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm actually the voice of the, I'm all the voices, the voiceovers and the Japanese ladies and the. And of course, I sing the end title. Kevin Hayes did. He and I.
See, now I have to watch it again. So, because I didn't realize that. Yeah, you sent me a few things. I'd like to, maybe jump on that for a minute.
And forgive any of the, like, some of it has some sort of, you know, promotional stuff with, you know.
Yeah, which
credits and things?
Which one of these?
Oh, well, we could do my ex-husband or the Chick Singers highlights. That's all about different singers. That was my one woman show. Let's see how long it is. Well, it's kind of long, so.
Well, we could watch some of it anyway.
Okay, yeah.
So this show, maybe you could tell us.
Oh, yes, I did this show. First, I did it at the HBO Workspace. Then I did it at the Cinegrill. It was directed by Clifford Bell. I did it at the Cinegrill like for a couple of runs. And then I did it, moved it to the Odyssey Theater, did it there. So, and I, let me see, was I blonde then? Yeah, I think so. It was in my blonde period.
And so can you just give us a a little rundown if in case we don't watch the whole thing?
Oh yeah. Well, it's actually it tracks the lives of about five or six chick singers, women singers. And it's a show about what different women go through when music is their life. So it's really about these characters, and they're fictional, but you follow their lives, and at the end I come out as myself, and you know, talk about, you know, what music means and how, you know, and I do the there's a quote from what's her name, the dancer. Oh, I should have gotten this quote.
Oh,
about the, you know,
about
there, yeah, if you, there's a
comes through you.
Yeah, and you're unique. There's only one of you in all time, and if you block it,
Martha Graham. Yes.
Thank you, Martha Graham's quote. I actually printed that out and handed it out to the audience.
Oh,
to
take home. Nice.
But it's, yeah. So it's really all about that, and it encourages people to go and, you know, sing their song. Again, getting back to that notion that we all have a melody. We all have a song to sing in life, and that these women had their song.
Now, I'm supposing that you did one and then completely, and then you moved on to the next.
No. It was done like you went back and forth. You know, there's a little French girl who, you know, you meet as a little girl, and then you meet her as a Lido dancer, and then you meet her as a waitress in a restaurant, and she's waiting on the opera singer who is the, you know.
Oh, wow.
You see, and then, yeah, and I mean, I have a couple of them in the same scene, so I would move from one to the other.
So is it best to start from the beginning on this?
Well, again, it's just going to be little clips. Yeah, I mean, it's sort of a promotional little video for it. So it'll kind of almost self-explain as you go, I guess. And then you can just cut it whenever it'll just give them a flavor.
Cool. Here we go.
I know a place where dreams are born.
I will tell you a secret. Everyone secretly wants to be a singer. It's true. My dear, you finally got it inside the lines.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome this year's Grammy winner for Best Female Jazz Vocalist, Miss Anita Mason.
Always late whenever we go on a date, but I love him, got to have him. If you aim at baby, the way you're acting lately makes me dazzled.
What second that man. No, he's not in right now. I'm sorry, I don't know. I said I don't know. Well, don't yell at me, sir. I am just a temp. What? If you want to pick a fight in person, I am now appearing every Thursday and Friday night at the Holiday Inn at LaGuardia and bring your friends. Yes! Tori, baby, hi, I can't believe you got me a disco on stage. I can't talk. Yeah. I know I did. Tori and I wanted to be there, but you know how important work is to mommy, don't you? Girl, you wouldn't mind, would you, Ma? I mean, you know how important my work is to me, don't you, Ma? Last week we did coffee fondue in a town that has no decaf coffee. Can you imagine? You knew I need my morning bagel and decaf. We've driven through entire states without one bagel. They should at least warn you with the state lines, street signs, bagels on them and red lines across them, entering bagel-free zones.
The best part of waking up is Folgers Eating. You come up!
Shit, headless is killing me.
Melody.
Feathers weigh so much.
Bitch. I hate that woman. Miriam Wells, the opera singer, the diva, the bitch.
Kindly
stop eyeing that insufferable French tart, Mr. Bing, if you ever wish to see my head between your legs again. Oh, that was quite fun last night, wasn't it?
I have always wanted to be a performer. I wanted my life to matter, you know? Music matters, right?
You stop right there, Harry Carver. I saw you. I saw you. You know where, you know with who. You said it was over, you lying son of a bitch. Quit the business? Me? This is the best thing I have ever known. Motherhood included, I'm sorry, Tori. Get out, get out, get out, get out, get out!
And I am you're not going. You're the best thing I've ever known. There's just no way, no way I'm gonna go. No, 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 no way. No, 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 no way I'm living without you. I'm not living without you. Not living without you. I don't want to be free.
I didn't think you'd do the whole thing. Well, wow. Was it out of sync? Because mine was out of sync. So
out of sync? What do you mean out of sync?
But my voice was like behind the thing. Did it look right to you?
Yeah, it looked right to me.
Oh, good. Oh, I'm so glad because I thought, oh gosh, everyone's going to be watching it out of sync. It must have been here. No, I was like going, and then all of a sudden the voice.
Oh, was, no. I mean, to me,
good.
I was.
Oh, good. Oh, great. Okay, good.
Yeah.
That brings tears to my eyes. I mean, oof. Really, I think I can't believe I did that. You know, very moving to me.
Yeah. What about it is moving to you?
You know, I'm sorry that I stopped doing it. I've actually thought about shooting it, you know, doing it now, and I could just shoot it and put it up online.
Yeah.
Which I might do.
Yeah.
It's so powerful. I mean, I guess the moving part about it, and it's the part that I address in the writing of it, these characters wanted something so much in their lives that music was so much a part of that longing, that need to be alive through the music. And in some cases, they're alive too much in the music, like the mother who's not there for the daughter, and there are all these sort of classic pitfalls of being an artist, and you know, the selfishness and the, but there's a necessity to the selfishness. There's a reason why, it's not an excuse for being an asshole by any means,
yeah,
but there are certain, a certain focus that in a life, that if you're devoting it toward that, that it, you know, it becomes a priority, but in a way, if it's how you breathe. I mean, someone actually said to me, Perry Botkin, my dear friend Perry Botkin, whom I love. I don't know if Perry's watching. Perry. And I got my therapist through him, so we know each other that long. A lot of lunches, a lot of talk. And, it is that, you know, the finding that place of who you are that expresses in life through your art. And sometimes it's through your business, and my book talks a lot about how creativity is, we're all creative, so.
Yeah.
Not identified as such, but the choices we make choices constantly, and that's where, you know, the choice is part of your shaping of your life, and that's a part of your creativity. So anyway, I can't even remember what the point I was making, but
You were very moved. You're very moved by
the show was like an expression of what I was talking about earlier, that, you know, that life comes through you. The life force comes through you. You know, your art comes through you. That's the, you know, feeling that I take dictation, you know. And it's a terrible feeling when you're trying to write something and you don't hear anything and you're going, where is it? You know, I actually, when we did this sequestering stuff, when the COVID hit and we were, I mean, for the first like couple of months, I couldn't write. I couldn't think. It just all went silent. And it was very strange. But I was moving out of my house and doing like straightening up things here at Mike's. And so there was a whole other thing going on that the space got occupied. So that kind of.
Yeah, I think everybody went through that. Everybody that I've talked to, including myself. Yeah. I experienced something from watching that, but of course your experience is, you know, it's your experience. You wrote it, each character, which is probably has part of you in each character, and you're performing and you're giving it your total all. And so there's a lot I can imagine that you are attached to in that, or, you know, brought up or tapped into.
And part of it is like, wow. I mean, I don't know whether you've found this with things you write or something, you'll like go back having not seen them for a while. And it's like, you forget that you wrote it. You know what I mean? It has a life. It's like separate, even hearing the album and going, wow, that, yeah, you know, it's sort of, you know, you become, and Richard, my shrink, had said to me once, it's not your job to judge it, it's your job to do it.
Yeah.
As an artist, you can't, because I mean, everybody comes in with their hammer. I mean, I come in with the hammer and go after myself pretty good. So it's really a lesson to kind of not do that.
Yeah, and also when you create, I'll just put it this way, a real piece of art, like something that really is from that special magical universe, it's timeless. So when you hear it or watch it again, it brings you right back to that spot, which is powerful. That's why, I mean, that's why we do it, you know, a big part of why we do it, to create that magical spot and to give it a life and put it here so that people can experience it, you know?
And I guess there's that thing that even the song, which is that wonderful song. That
great song, yeah.
Oh my goodness. That you're gonna love me.
Yeah.
That's kind of what a lot of artists are driven by.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like the happiest children don't necessarily grow up to be artists, you know. I mean, not always, but it's like an itch you're trying to scratch in your life.
Who doesn't want to be loved?
Well,
I mean, that's what we're here. That's what we're doing all the time, right?
Yeah, that's right. It certainly feels good when you know you're in that flow. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, yeah, very powerful. Liz Finch is here, and she said, that's great. Yeah, my friend Dan Davila, Bonnie Janofsky.
Oh, you know, hi, Bonnie. She's in the choir. You know about the National Enquirer, right? Rosemary Butler, you know Rosemary?
Yeah.
Wonderful, wonderful singer and background singer.
Course, yeah.
And anyway, she and I, it's been, I think last year was the 38th year. We have a choir that has been going, I've been directing the choir for 38 years.
Oh.
And we go to hospitals and homes and GV Hall, and we got to the Actors Home and Children's Hospital and all these places just in the month of December, sing Christmas carols. And it's all volunteers. We've had hundreds and hundreds of singers have come through the choir. Linda Ronstadt came with us 1 year, and Al Jarreau came with us 1 year. And it's really been just, it's like the finest thing I do. Except when I sing at the High Holidays. I sing Cedars-Sinai for their High Holiday service, and that's another, I love using the voice with the purpose of lifting the spirit. That really.
What is the name of the choir that sings?
It's called the National Enquirer. And we have people who, yes, exactly. And we've had people for years and years, and a lot of people you know have sung in it, and you know, the Joyces and, you know, Roger Phelan. I wonder if Edie did, and I don't know if Sally ever did, but I don't know if Sally's here, but we emailed, so I'm hoping I'd see her. But anyway, it's some wonderful, wonderful singers. And, but it's really a gift. It's just like pure gift. It's where you like set your ego aside and you go, this is not about anybody. It's about and Mike came with us last year. I think this year is going to be the first year in all these years. Even when I was in cancer treatment, I think I went with a mask. I had breast cancer. For those who don't know, I had breast cancer 16 years ago. So didn't want to spring that on everybody. But I'm fine. But the girls were just examined. We're fine. But I mean, Mike came with us, and we went down to do the mission downtown, which we've been singing for years. It's really weird because I like know some of the guys now. And they go, yeah. Hey, how are you doing? I'm like, oh, hi. And I bring them up to sing and ring the bells with me, and like their breath is like, whew, it's like the cocktail, the 10 a.m. cocktail. It's like, whoa. But they're so lifted by it. You can't not do it. And it's, you know, but anyway, so May came the year that this was about a year ago, and I, for the first time, I gotten the date wrong. They had moved it because it was on a weekend. Christmas was on a weekend, so they moved. Anyway, so we decided there were like whatever 15, 20 of us there. We get as many as 50 people at a gig. We used to do it at the Music Center for the holiday celebration. Anyway, so we just walk down the street in Los Angeles, and it's lined on either side.
It's what?
Lined with tents, with people.
Oh, yeah.
Living, it's like San Pedro Street. It's like for blocks. And so we just went down and sang on the street all the way down. And it was, you know, as moving, if not more, than doing it in the mission where they all come there to get their meal, you know. It's really a sad statement about our country at this point that this is existing.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I'm not sure.
My grandmother, the governor.
I want to sit down and have a word with him. It's like,
yeah.
What are you thinking? You know,
we've got some
apparently not thinking. Yeah, no. Oh, Sally is here. She's so.
Oh, lovely. Yay! Hi, Sally.
Hi, Sally. So, see, what I mean.
I don't know what time it is. Do we want to bring Mr. Mike to join us or?
Yeah. So, for those.
If you wanted to do it earlier than later.
Sure. For those of you who don't know this, Deborah's partner is Mike Lang, and Mike's been on the show. The fabulous, fabulous pianist, human. Mike Lang.
Pianist, human.
Hello.
Is this on the radio show? Wow. Very cool.
Yeah, we were accompanying your work on the computer.
It was very nice.
Oh, thank you. Good.
Yeah. She's got talent. She can do at least two or three different things.
Thank you, honey. We'll look into a fourth just for you.
So fast, I can't keep up with it. Anyway, I should probably say something about the song we're about to do.
Yes, I think you should say something.
I composed the music, and it was originally an instrumental song. David Page and I were working on an album that we never kind of got finished, but we were both writing original material, and it was kind of a modern jazz meets contemporary music kind of thing. Some of the stuff had a little bit of kind of Weather Report attitude and was joyous and uplifting. And this tune, I wrote it and I called it, I wrote it, then I kind of figured out a title, A Rural State of Mind. And the idea was to be in a rural place, but I wasn't a rural guy. So it was a state of mind rather than I was living in Wichita, Kansas, writing this song. And then I invited Miss Deborah Pearl to write a lyric to the song, and she will take it from there, and I will go sit in my chair.
Yeah, let's make sure your chair is, you can see him, because he plays so pretty.
Do I need to turn you up? Now,
Deborah, did you want to move your other mic in?
Oh yeah, let's do that. Okay, yeah, we're doing, this is real high tech here. We're going to engage two mics and see if that helps. Okay, and I've got my. I may be referring to.
Oh, Barbara Bentry is saying thanks, Mike, for inviting me to this great hang.
Ah.
Was it
Barbara Bentry?
Yes.
Barbara Bentry, thanks. Well, you
know, while you guys were doing the show, I was sending invitations to about 600 people. I got Abraham Lincoln. I got.
Well, yeah. Barbara and her partner John Rangel, they're going to be on in a few weeks.
Oh, great!
Wonderful. They've done this incredible documentary film of Dave Grusin, which is now coming to be fully released.
Pretty wonderful. Yeah.
I love the film. It's amazing. This is in his way.
Really great. I miss John Rangel. He was here for a while and, you know, worked with us live. Wow. Right, Mike?
Where is he now?
They're in Arizona.
Oh, okay.
She and Barbara.
And actually, we didn't say it, but we should say it to everybody out there. Just stay safe. Stay safe, stay safe. It's, you know, these are weird, scary times.
Yeah.
Talk about the lyric contribution you made. No.
Oh, honey, you want to turn your phone off? That would be good.
Ray Charles is calling.
Actually, I don't. Oh, my phone's over there. Someone might call me too. He gave me the thing, Rural State of Mind, and I'll say this about it: when you're writing screenplays, you know, which are 100 and something pages, a lyric is like an amuse-bouche. It's so refreshing to have one page to do. And it's, you know, because it's normally, it's a story, but it's a, you know, you tell it in a page. So I am really so enjoy lyric writing for that reason, because it is just so much.
You know, Deb, you could move the computer just a little so that the angle of the,
absolutely.
A little more high.
Okay. And we'll try and see if this works better. I just didn't want the mic on him. There you go. Is that better?
That's probably great.
Okay. Here we go. One, two.
Never thought of you come back, go traveling, rambling through my mind. I close my eyes, take a trip, and wander back through time. Our sunny days were oh so happy, we were young and free. And all that really mattered, you and me. Hit the open road and ride, wind blowing, flowing through our hair. Nothing ever in our way, a world without a care. We built the fire that burned inside us, up under a tree. 'Cause all that really mattered, you and me. All at once I feel all my worries melt away, and I feel like the way I did that day. All at once you're here with the sun, the open road. With you I find a rural state of mind. Subway commuter, dreaming me back to you. Never thought that you'd come back, go traveling, rambling through my mind. Close my eyes, see you home, you're the one I find. For all our rainy days are sunny, 'cause we stay young and free. And love is all that matters, you and me. All at once I feel worries melt away, and I feel like the way I did that day. All at once you're here with the sun, the open road. In my thoughts of you is where I You take me to a rural state of mind.
Yay. Nice. What a great song all around.
Thank you. Thank
great you. Performance, too.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, honey.
I'll be back.
Yeah, we'll
I'll come back for the encore.
Okay.
You don't want to do the other one, right? We can talk some more and then do the other one.
Either way, it's fine.
Do you want to do the other one or do you want to do? No, Keith, he wants us to talk some more.
All right.
Okay. And if he doesn't say, then we talk some more. There we go.
So the some other things that you had sent me links to was My Ex-Husband Gets Married.
Oh, gosh, yes. that was from the musical called At the Bistro Garden.
Uh-huh.
Music and lyrics are by David Cole. It's a wonderful arranger and guitarist and musician and wonderful musician and composer. That was a musical about the ladies who lunch. And he had the characters and had brought me in to sing for the demos. And he didn't have the piece written. He just wanted to do the demos and had the ideas.
Wait, the ladies who lunch, was that?
Well, that's a song in one of, I think it was in the, here's to the ladies who lunch. It was
that
was a wonderful song. But this is just about those kind of ladies. It's called
Okay.
Garden. And it was sort of based on David's original idea about the bistro garden in Beverly Hills that ultimately closed. They're still in a bistro garden here in the valley. But, but anyway, so he had these women and they weren't all that specific, but I ended up writing the book. So I ended up, you know, making the characters more specific and gave them stories and the whole arc and the whole stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And it takes place at the Bistro Garden. And so I played BJ in a production. It was produced by Lucinda Bridges, who is, you know, Jeff and Beau's sister, who's just, she's a doll. In fact, I owe you a call if you're here. I sent her the invitation. we reconnected and we got disconnected. And then
that happens a lot right now.
It's sort of like the pandemic fog, you know. I have no sense of time is just a little bit swirly now. Anyway. So anyway, it's we did the show out at the Hidden Hills Theater.
Yeah.
And beautiful, they have a beautiful facility out there. And I played BJ, this character, and the song was David had such a wonderful, wicked sense of humor. It's called My Ex-Husband Gets Married Today. So it's fraught, as you can imagine. And that's the setup.
Cool. Okay, let me get full screen. Okay, here we go.
Another one, madam? Are we going for a record today?
Oh, no. But I would like it above me a cigarette.
Oh,
anything but menthol.
Are you sure, Mrs. Beston?
Positive. And no cheating. Don't buy a pack.
Rats busted.
Are you all right?
Terrific. I always drink lunch when I breakfast with Lance.
You had breakfast with Lance?
Just breakfast?
It still must be kind of difficult.
What's difficult, Sarmi?
She had breakfast with Lance.
You slept with him?
Breakfast.
Just breakfast? You know, if you slept with him, I'd understand.
But we are friends, just
This is all I could find, Mrs. Beston. It's meatball.
Keith,
Give me that. Okay, what happened? He's seeing someone.
You're warm.
Living with someone?
Very hot.
He's not getting
married, yes. And she's very young. But what really grinds me is he knocked this one up.
When?
How the hell should I know when? I didn't ask what position they were in.
I meant, when is the wedding?
This afternoon. They are eloping.
And he had breakfast with you?
Yeah, go figure.
Well, a lot can happen between now and this afternoon. Their whole lives can come crashing down in an instant.
Well, there's a cheery thought.
BJ, I'm not going to say that everything happens for the best because, okay, you'll hit me, but look at yourself. I think it's time you call it quits with Lance all together.
Why? It's not like it matters. I just want you to know. He left me in tatters a long time ago. So I feel not a thing when I say my ex-husband gets married today. Imagine the flowers he probably got on sale. The bridegroom, the coward, he'll lie through her veil. But muzzled up, bundle up, and God bless, I'm impressed by the headlock that wedlocked my ex. I feel sorry now for the bride. Her Lothario's wink will put a kink in her stride. The circumsaddiction of laughter and rage. The groom and his victim, the captor, the cage. And the minister would have every right to pronounce them as scumbag and BJ, don't be nuts with you. She's prettier than BJ, but so was I at 22.
I can hear my mother.
It's a kind we did. You shall get this age. Not enough for some boil, they should both be ashamed. She'll ask about the house. She has still kept the house, that's the least we could do. Complain about her life. Now and then when it rains, never mind. My mind. My years, adored all his virtues, ignored his mistakes, and I truly felt, oh God, we were one. My ex-husband met me quite young. Once upon a time, love came gently, slipped inside your heart through the cracks. When you're young, it comes accidentally. Now it's like a job, like a deal, just a fact. Once upon a time, I was buried happily inside someone else. Once upon a time, I was married, living in a house just big enough to avoid my shame. Matters, but you can't account for taste. She gets a husband, and I get replaced. And though I give him 6 months tops, who can say my ex-husband gets married again? Married today.
great. I actually choked up there.
Yeah, it's I get choked up because I never married. I always say I at least want to have a chance to get divorced, damn it.
Well, getting divorced isn't that great.
No, I got
divorced once.
Yeah. Oh, really? What was it like? No.
Yeah, the worst okay. thing was like, okay. Wait a minute, wait, are you the person that I was just married to for 17 years? It's like,
what fascinates me about that, how people can love one another enough to marry, I mean, to really to do that thing,
yeah.
for someone who's never gotten to there. To get there and then to like be so mean to each other and so, you know, to not want to go, didn't work. I'm not happy you're gonna have it. Bye bye. You know what I mean? It's just, I still marvel at that. I mean, I understand it. I do, but I,
yeah.
you know, I don't miss that. Let's put it that way.
That's a whole other show.
Yeah. yeah really. That would be a whole other show.
I was curious. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I was curious about your singing.
If we were in the same room, you know, I would have plastered myself on the other side of the wall.
I know. I always have to, whenever, because I have a chronic cough. So whenever I cough nowadays, I'm always like, I'm not sick. It's a chronic cough, right. you know, and
really.
my family knows. Yeah. I was curious, do you still practice vocalizing? Have you ever practiced vocalizing? You have a really strong, nice voice.
Oh, thank you. No, I do, like this morning, and you know, I'll do some. I have, you know, Rosemary Butler is a wonderful teacher, and she has warm up and jam, have some of her exercises and stuff. And I mean, I studied in New York, and I've been studying for a long time, so. But I normally just, you know, I'll do that kind of stuff just to get the frogs out. And
you had a very high range too. I heard one of the songs. Yeah, I heard you went very high.
Yeah, the tone changes, but yeah, I.
Well, yeah, the tone's gonna change.
Yeah. I've always admired, like Rose has this belt, this high belt that I just, you know. I couldn't, I mean, my cords would be splattered on either side of my throat. I couldn't do it, but I've always really admired that. But I can change the tone and do, and get up there. I can get three octaves and, you know, that are reasonable.
Like people aren't going to really throw tomatoes at you.
Yeah, well, I must say the Benny Carter stuff is so rangy. He wrote those melodies for a saxophone. So it, you know, they go all over the place, and even Mike's stuff. I've worked on a couple other tunes of his that I have lyric to, and you know, they really do like finding the right key for me is so critical because they go, you know, for an instrumental, it was obviously not a problem in the writing of it. It just the execution becomes an issue.
Yeah, I understand. I always have to, especially if I'm writing lyrics for somebody. Many times I have to change the keys, and even then it's not really necessarily, like you say, it can be so rangy that in any key it's going to be awkward unless you're Nancy King and you change the octaves, you know, like it the octave, the second to the bridge should be up here, but right. She shifts it down here.
Well, because I mean there are places to put it where the way you hit the note, even the lyric and the vowel that you hit it can be easier. So each song, it just depends on, you know, where the low sounds better for the majority of the song. And then you hit the high thing somewhere where it goes by quickly.
Well, in Michael's song, there was a little interval that was interesting. Bum, bum, or some. There was.
Yeah. All at once, I do.
Went by fast. It went high and back.
That little. And in. Yeah. I know what you're meaning. Let's see. Uh, And all that really mattered. It's like almost a little yodel, you know.
Yeah.
Really. I can sing it out of tune now.
And that takes talent.
No. I have to tell you, I've recently, in all the crap I got from my house, I uncovered the Darlene and Jonathan Edwards tapes. You know, I've in fact, the Charleses gave those to me like 100 in the 80s. You know? And oh my God, you know, and I've never laughed so hard. And I do one character in Chick Singers is a woman who's not a, she's like a church singer. And I think she's singing, you know, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. Where she's just sliding all over the place. You really have to concentrate.
Yeah, it's not easy.
Singing off the thing, yeah.
I know, I have often thought that of them. And when I was at Berkeley, the man who wrote Double Your Pleasure, Double Your Fun. So he was at school and he did that. He would do that. He'd sit at the piano and just play terribly and sing totally off key. Like, oh my God, how is he doing that? It's so hard. But Jonathan and Darlene, you know, don't get around much anymore. And the Bee Gees, June, April in Paris. Oh my God.
Yeah, and he did so hilarious runs where he'd do something run and then just sort of dribble.
Oh, hysterical.
Just so funny.
You know, I had Tim Weston on, you know, about a month ago. And so, of course, we had to talk about it because it was his parents.
Yeah, of course.
And just too much, man. Too much. And I'm always afraid to play it on a show like this because people who don't understand that Jonathan and Darlene Edwards was a comedy routine, yeah. You know, they're like, what is going on? Who she thinks that's and good? Edwards, and
like, oh my God, but yeah, no, it's amazing. I was told that they started doing it at parties,
yes,
and it was so popular, everybody just fell out after they started recording it.
Yes, that's true. Barbara Lynn said, it's so great
Barbara
to
Lynn.
See you and hear you.
Oh, how great! Hi, B Lane. We would go back to college, Barnard together.
Oh.
long way back. Yeah, a long way back.
Cool. So, okay. So let's see. In your, you know, I'm so impressed. I really didn't know all of this about you. I mean, this is a lot of stuff and you're such a professional in these areas. And I mean, I kind of knew, but I really didn't totally. So I'm quite impressed. Not that you care that I'm impressed, but but
really,
I'm just saying, I'm impressed.
It was a whole lot better than if you just went, eh.
Yeah, that's true.
It feels good on this end, so that's why.
Okay, so, and then, so, was there something else in between, or was this kind of basically up to now, were you...
There was other stuff. So I did, you know, I did a lot of performing in clubs and stuff with Lou Forestieri and his trio.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we played the...
Excuse me. You know, was that Lou on the record or was that
yes,
Mike?
Yes. No, that was Lou on the right. No, Lou. Oh, okay. Mike and I were not... Yeah.
And who Lou, else was in the band on that Benny Carter record?
Oh, yes. Unbelievable. Great guys. I think Kenny Wilde and Jimmy Branley.
Oh.
Bass and drum. And also Chris Colangelo. But he and Kenny did the basses. And Dave Carasone and Jimmy Branley did the drums. But on the first one, Doozy Blues, that was Jimmy,
mm-hmm.
Jimmy and Kenny. Yeah.
Great band. Great band.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
Yeah.
And Jimmy also did some mixing and, you know, did some of the recording and stuff. And he's awesome. He's such a talent and a really beautiful guy. And Lou, I mean, Lou is the best. And
yeah.
We go way, way back. And Corliss Dale, his wife, who's a wonderful singer.
Just yeah.
But no, it's as I say, that was just the perfect connect for me with Lou for that project. It was brilliant. He just did a great job.
So you were about to say what happened in between.
Oh yeah. So we did, I did that. Then Let's see, I was doing the I did the music and then the theater stuff. And then I started writing movies.
Oh.
Left the half hour television, I started writing film. And a play of mine, one of the things I did, this just shows you how things lead to other things, that I studied Torah. I love studying Torah. I'm Jewish, and I love studying Torah.
Nice.
The philosophy of it, it's just very nourishing to my soul. It's
yeah.
so much rich information about human nature and how we are and why we're the way we are. Anyway, I had a Torah class with a group called the Avichai Group. There was a group in New York that funded writers and producers to study Torah so that they would get Torah value into their work.
Wow.
Which was great.
Oh,
so we had wonderful teachers, great rabbis. And one of them was Levi Meir, who was the chaplain at Cedars-Sinai Medical Center for years and years. And he became our teacher. And I developed such a strong relationship with him. He was, you know, and his wife, Marcy, is just a wonderful woman. And the rabbi loved art. It was something he was a therapist as well as leading the, you know, and he actually got sick and passed away some years ago, which was devastating for all of us. But in the Torah study, I met Tor Freudenthal, who came to a play reading of mine, a play called Fathers and Sons, about three sets of fathers and sons, one Jewish, one African-American, and one Palestinian, and all their lives connected. And so that it's actually so much more timely. I thought that one was gonna like be so not relevant over time. It's so much more, you know, I have a talk with the father to the son about the police and it's just all come to life in a horrible way. But at any rate, and it was done in underserved schools. It got a grant to do, did it in underserved schools a year ago. And
cool.
Yeah, I mean, some of these kids had never seen any theater at all. I mean, it
was something. Fantastic.
But at any rate, so Tor was coming out of Cal Arts, and he's just a wonderful director. So he asked me if I would write with him. So I spent a number of years writing projects with him, and we wrote three movies. A couple got close to getting made, but they didn't. They got optioned, and you know. And then when we developed, treatments for things, and you know, we worked a lot. He ended up going on to directing big studio family movies, Hotel for Dogs, which I ended up doing an uncredited pass on, and. And then he did the latest Percy Jackson, and he did what was the other one he did the first Wimpy Kid, Diary of a Wimpy Kid. And he just has a new one that's just come out. It's called Words on Bathroom Walls, which is his first indie thing that he did. But he's true. I mean, I love Tor, and we had a wonderful working relationship for a long time, and now he's you know how that is, where you see people and then they ascend and you
you know I have a lot of friends like that.
Like Ted Danson was my acting coach for it's so funny. You'll love this story. When we were doing At the Bistro Garden, And Cindy Bridges was friendly with David Cole, and that's how I met them. So,
yeah.
And so they were doing a fundraiser for the Malibu Stage Company.
Uh-huh.
So I was going to sing with David like three songs from the musical. So I get a call from Lucinda, and she goes, "Put your poo-poo pants on." She said, "Barbara's coming." So it turns out that because Barbara Streisand was friendly with her brother Jeff, that she was coming to the fundraiser at Lucinda's house. So that night, and Ted Danson's there, who I had not seen in a long time, and everybody's coming up to me, like, "Are you okay? Are you going to be okay?" this is like doing the a Hamlet for Olivier, you know. And of course, it's in her living room. And she and Jim Brolin come, you know, they go into the bedroom, and then they come out and they sit, and of course they sit right in front, like right at the couch, like right in front of me. And it was just so funny because I was like trying so hard to not, you know, look
not
at her.
Care.
And not care. That was essentially it. And of course we did the songs, and she could not have been sweeter, and came up and she said, "Oh, do you vocalize?" And she was only, you know, into asking me about the singing stuff. So, and she reminded me of my sister. So I felt felt comfortable with her instantly. And and then, you know, we stood in the buffet line. It was just, you know, it's just so interesting. I mean, the whole notion of fame and that sort of extreme fame, and you know, how it's kind of something that happens to you. You can't do it. It just has to happen to you. And the people that I've known who've had it, you know, some of them, you know, handle it well, and some of it handle it less well. And when all is said and done, they have to put their shoes on and go to the bathroom and, you know,
yeah,
and have families and all that crap that, you know, just takes some, you know, attention.
Yeah. Oh. Hey, you want to do your second song?
Yes, honey. Speaking of attention, is there a piano player in the house? Hello, is there a piano player in the house? Uh-oh, who are you?
I came to audition for the role of accompanist.
Okay.
Look at you.
Okay. I'll tell you the nice thing about the two of us is that we're both like such children, I have to say. We really enjoy like goofing around, and I love that about him.
Disclaimer.
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 You know, disclaimer or disclaimer?
I know. Cousin to disclavier.
I have to say a disclaimer that this song has some adult chords in it.
So. This is the Benny Carter tune. I'm going to explain the song.
Explain the song. When you mention who it was written for, explain who he is, because some people
these people are going to know. Well, I'll explain. This is a tune. It's the title song of the CD, and it's a melody that Benny wrote when Johnny Hodges died, who was another just amazing saxophone player. He and Benny actually were the creators of the template for the swing era. So, you know, he wrote this and played it for like 20 years. And he played with the Ellington Band, yes? He played with the Ellington Band?
Yes,
he was the lead alto on the Ellington. Yeah. So anyway, so, you know, he played it for 20 years. And so I knew the name was Souvenir, and I knew that I wanted the lyric to honor Benny. And it also, again, getting back to that, oh my goodness, we're going full circle. This is like so.
So cool.
The heaven part. Yes, that's right. In the zone or something. Because, you know, he just honored, you know, he honored the artist in him. I honored the artist in Benny, and that every one of us has a melody, that we all have an artist within us, the one that kind of paints our own life. And so this honors everyone, but I actually sing it now to honor all of the people that have been affected by COVID. I still can't really wrap my head around the notion of that many people that have been taken from us. It's just, you know. So anyway, this goes out to all those who have lost anyone. It's called Souvenir of You.
Okay.
I'm gonna bring this in here. Okay.
You can pull this back.
No, that's okay. No, because that's okay. The camera. I'm fine. Okay. Thanks. Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Love comes and goes. Of those I still remember you. Pulling me through all of those years of tears and laughter. Treasure forever to me, gone and yet magically touching me lovingly with your song. Your inspiration notes of pure elation, river and rhyme, one of a kind, end of the line. Now guardian at heaven's door, leaving me wanting more. Still hear your joy come through, your song sung happy.
Great. Boy, that's beautiful.
Thank
you. You guys Thank played you. That beautifully.
Thank you. That's funny.
See you all, everybody.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Mike Lang.
Thank you, Mike Lang.
Yeah.
Miami.
Really beautiful. I'm gonna ask.
Sorry. Yeah, that's.
That's okay. We're actually, believe it or not, we're
Mike Campbell's song.
Did you say Mike Campbell?
Glenn Campbell.
Oh, the Glenn Campbell song. Oh, I thought you said Mike Campbell. Yeah, we're actually coming to the end of 2 hours.
Wow.
Yeah, it's
really fun. I mean, I forgive me for not asking about you. I've all of a sudden realized, gee, what kind of a lopsided conversation is this?
That's okay.
Not me.
No, that's okay, because it is a hang, but it's kind of more about you. So, you know, I mean, I'll throw in little things, but yeah, anyway.
You have to have a thing.
Yeah. Yes, definitely. This has led to, you know, like drinks on Zoom, you know. So
it's gonna leave the lunch here, but
that was beautiful. You're gonna hear from me. I'm gonna ask you for a few charts.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
I'd love to sit down and play that and sing it. It's really quite beautiful. Also, Mike's song, I really loved.
Any singers out there who want any of these, because there's some of them are up, and there's all kinds of interesting stuff. I'm happy to start.
There you go. I know Cecily's there. Oh, Cecily says, I think you should hire that guy as your accompanist. That was a great audition.
Well, I'll take that under advisement. That's going to have more to do with him.
He plays so beautiful. It's interesting that even on this format, which isn't, you know, the best for just the piano, but you can still, it's just great when a great player such as Mike sits down at the piano and he can just play, you know, four chords, and it's just, it takes you right into your heart, right into the space. It's really beautiful. So,
sometimes he'll just sit and play. And I'm just like, you know, and even the dog comes and lays down next to him. It's like the music is so like, I know this is good. I can't eat it, but it's good.
Right. Those darn dogs.
Love
them. Well,
I'm on a stool.
Again, thank you so much for this beautiful hang. Do you want to say anything to the people out here?
I just thank you all for coming to be with me. And some of you I haven't seen in a long time. And some of you, it's been too long since I have. And I just, you know, send you all big virtual hugs. And, you know, I really look forward to being able to be with you and swap air with you. It would be really nice to have our lives back.
Yeah.
Everybody, please, thank you, and also stay safe.
Okay. And guys, if you want to contribute to something, there's so many things to contribute to, but one thing is the California Jazz Foundation, which actually provides financial help specifically to jazz musicians in California. So that's something we are.
California Jazz Foundation.
California Jazz Foundation, you know, which is specifically provides financial help to jazz musicians in California, so there's a link at the end of, you know, the edited part up above. And if you want to, even $10 is nice, you know. Right. And tomorrow, I hope you guys come back tomorrow when Deeds is on, Diane Shore.
Oh, right. Oh, wow. Oh, gosh. That's going to be great. Very good.
And Mike, I'll be sure to say hi for you. Oh, good. She's really cute. She's a doll. And she has an adorable 13-year-old cat.
Oh, wow. Where's the boy? Let's see if we can get the... You want to see Yardley?
Sure.
Before we go?
Oh.
Here, you want to pick him up? Can you get him some? Here we go. There's the yard.
Okay.
This is Yardley.
Hi, Yardley. Oh, is he ready to sing?
Yes.
He's adorable.
When the UPS guy comes or anybody comes, he yelps pretty good. He's a big guard dog.
Yeah.
He is adorable. Pocket. God, is he cute?
Oh, he's cute. Yeah, I call him stupid cute.
Was he one of your dogs before you got together, or?
Yeah, he was my dog. He was a rescue, and he had been abused. Can you imagine who could abuse this? I mean, you know, that was a problem.
You know, one question I wanted to ask before we go: how did you guys meet?
Oh
well, you got another 2 hours.
No, Perry Botkin, who actually, I mean, I love Perry. Perry was. You know, he's such an important friend because I got my therapist through him 40 years ago, and Mike, and it we knew each other. It's just sort of
we
in
knew
circles,
each other.
Just
yeah,
as
we'd
in
see
circles.
Each other at gatherings,
Jim Wilson's Grammy party, something like that. Yeah. But he would have join us for lunch occasionally, and when he was having a difficult time with his marriage, and he had a lunch with us, I had never seen him so. Upset. So I just gave him a call a couple days later and said, you know, I'm around. If you need a friend, I'm here. And, you know, and then like a couple weeks later, he calls me like, you know, 6 o'clock. Hey, would you like to go to dinner? I'm like, what am I, the 12th phone call? You know, 6 o'clock, you know, 14. We'll have dinner at 6:30, you know, no, but it was great. And then we had so much fun. And
the rest was history.
History is.
Yeah, it's been very special.
It's very
As you
special.
Can tell, she's a very special human being.
She's a very special human being.
So are you.
Yes, you are too.
Before, I don't know when this is ending, but I just want to say, we're still on the air?
Yes, we are.
I just want to say what you're doing with this show, and you're bringing so many people in and giving them a different exposure than they've had. And you've always been a community person. You've always been so great helping people. And the show is just an extension of everything you've always been.
Oh, thank you.
I mean, what an archive. Oh, my goodness. This is amazing.
Yeah. Well, everybody's really special, aren't we all?
That's the deal, you know?
Yeah. I know. We all have something to offer.
Life force. Yeah.
Yeah. But thank you. Love you guys a lot.
Yeah, you too.
Have a beautiful day.
Look forward to seeing you.
Yes,
in real
you too.
Life.
Thanks.
You too. Let's have a drink on the lawn.
Yeah, okay, we can do that. Absolutely.
Okay. Okay. Love you lots.
I love you.
Yeah.
Bye.